Hello students, welcome to Good Learners. This is Safiya Siddiqui and the chapter that we're going to be talking about today is From Trade to Territory. Here we will learn about the East India Company, which I'm sure you all have heard of. We will talk about how the company started as a trading company and went on to continue with its territorial expansion. So let's begin. Now we start by having a look at the political conditions in India then. So Aurangzeb was the last powerful Mughal ruler, and with his death, the fall of the Mughal Empire began. Different governors, subedars, began asserting their authority and establishing regional kingdoms all over the country, and thus Delhi was no longer an effective center. Now in the later part of the 18th century, Britain came up to be an important name in the politics all around the world. Let's see how. Now in 1600 AD, the East India Company acquired a formal charter, which is like a grant from the Queen, which gave them the sole right to trade with the East. So no other trading companies from England were allowed to trade with the East now. Okay, and this obviously had some positive effects, the first being that no competition from other English trading companies. The mercantile companies worked like this. So they bought goods at a cheaper rate in India and then sold them for more price in Britain. But the charter could only stop the British trading companies, right? Now the Portuguese, Dutch and the French already had a hold in India. So now competition was back. They bought cotton, silk and spices for low rate and sold for more in Britain. But the problem now was the competition. The solution to this was only that they blocked each other's routes, prevented ships from transportation, and this obviously led to conflict. Now the first English factory was set up on the banks of the river Hooghly in 1651. They set up a base here, and the traders, who were also known as factors, operated from here. Now as the trade expanded, the company bribed and persuaded the Mughal officials to issue a farman. Now what is a farman? It is like a royal order, okay, which granted the East India Company to trade duty free, that is without paying taxes. The company also started pressing the local rulers for more concession. Now some accepted, but some refused. The company, however, refused to pay the taxes, and so, agitated by this, Murshid Quli Khan, which was the then Nawab of Bengal, protested against this. Now the conflict between the company and the Nawab was only rising. Murshid Quli Khan was followed by Ali Wardi Khan, and then Siraj-ud-Daulah followed as the Nawab of Bengal. They were strong rulers and refused to grant concession to the company. They also denied them the right to mint coins and trade in particular. They even went further and accused the company of deceit and blamed them of not giving revenues, due to which Bengal was facing losses. The company, on the other hand, declared that for a healthy trade, they needed the taxes to be removed. Now all these conflicts had to come to a conclusion, right? The conclusion was the Battle of Plassey. Now with the death of Ali Wardi Khan, Siraj-ud-Daulah took over as the Nawab of Bengal, and he emerged as a strong and powerful Nawab. The company, on the other hand, wanted a puppet ruler who would, you know, grant them concessions and other privileges. Siraj-ud-Daulah ordered the company to stop peddling with the politics of Bengal. They also tried negotiating, but negotiations failed. So now the Nawab marched with 30,000 soldiers to the English factory. They locked the warehouse, disarmed all the Englishmen, and then marched to Calcutta to get to company's fort, which led to the fall of the Calcutta fort. Now the company was obviously going to respond. So under the command of Robert Clive, in 1757, Clive led the company's army against Siraj-ud-Daulah at Plassey. Now here's a plot twist. Clive promised Mir Jafar, who was a general of Siraj-ud-Daulah, the seat of the Nawab. And so the Mir Jafar's forces did not fight the battle, and due to this Siraj-ud-Daulah lost. This is a very important event in Indian history, as it was the first battle that the company won in India. So now after the defeat in the Battle of Plassey, Mir Jafar, as promised, was made the Nawab. Company wanted a puppet ruler who would, you know, grant them all the privileges, and they got one. But then the main focus still was to expand trade and not political annexation. But often it became difficult to control the puppet rulers, because sometimes they refused to oblige. And due to this, Mir Jafar was followed by Mir Qasim, and then again Mir Jafar was made the Nawab. But then he had to pay 5 lakhs every month as a payback. The company was becoming more and more greedy and they wanted more money. Now with the death of Mir Jafar, the company officials finally decided that they need to be Nawabs themselves. So now finally in 1765, Mughals appointed the company as the Diwan of the Bengal province. This allowed them to use vast amount of resources of Bengal. So now they could use the money from the Bengal court. This solved the East India Company's problem too. Now they had enough money to buy the goods from India and sell them at a higher rate in England. Unlike earlier when they used to trade the goods from India with gold and silver from Britain. Now with the Diwani rights in the picture, the actual Nawab of Bengal were forced to give money and land as gifts to the company. When we talk of Robert Clive too, even he amassed great fortunes from India. But not all company officials could survive in India. They used to die due to the harsh weather or due to diseases. Their main goal was to earn enough money to live a comfortable life in England. But in England, they were considered as social climbers and ridiculed. So to summarize, if we look at the pattern of annexation by the East India Company, there was no military attack. They in fact opted for political, economic and diplomatic methods to extend their territories in India. Now after the Battle of Buxar, the company also started appointing residents. Now who were these people? They were like agents whose job was to help the company in their rule in India. So they used to advise in political matters of the state. Now we also have the concept of a subsidiary alliance. Company often forced the states into this. Now if you sign this alliance, it meant that the Indian states were no longer allowed to have their armies of their own for protection. The company would have their army or subsidiary forces sent for protection of the state, and the state would have to pay extra money for it. How ridiculous is that? And upon that, if they failed to make the payment, then the part of their territory was taken away by the company. So this is how they played diplomatic games to extend their territory in India. Hyderabad also was taken over in a similar manner under the governance of Richard Wellesley. So now students, with this we come to the end of the first video of your chapter. If you like the content, please like, share and comment. If you haven't subscribed already to Good Learners, please do subscribe. Thank you.